What up, Mike? Toronto. VK on the beat. Check. I'm in Toronto, where you wanna get the city love. I'm from Toronto, where you wanna get the city love. Okay. I'm in Toronto, Mike, we wanna get the city love. So my city love me back.
Welcome to episode 1058 of Toronto Mic'd, proudly brought to you by Great Lakes Brewery, a fiercely independent craft brewery who believes in supporting communities, good times, and brewing amazing beer. Order online for free local home delivery in the GTA. StickerU.com. Create custom stickers, labels, tattoos, and decals for your home and your business. Palma Pasta. Enjoy the taste of fresh, homemade Italian pasta and entrees from Palma Pasta in Mississauga and Oakville. Doer. The world's most comfortable pants and shorts. Save 15% with the promo code TMDS. Ridley Funeral Home. Pillars of the community since 1921. And Canna Cabana, the lowest prices on cannabis, guaranteed. Over 100 stores across the country. Learn more at CannaCabana.com. Joining me this week, making his Toronto Mic debut, is Mike Hanafin.
How are you, sir?
Good, and don't call me sir, it makes me nervous, but how you doing, Mike?
I'm doing fantastic. It is my pleasure to be here and to see this greatest use of economical space I have ever seen in my life.
I was wondering where you were going with that.
Because this, when you see this...
on the stream, right?
It looks like you've got this massive studio, and this is like the size of my small little kitchen. It's fantastic. It's awesome.
You know, I've heard this from people who, when they finally see this space that they've been seeing on live streams and for so long, in their mind, I guess, you kind of think it's this big studio thing. And you're right. It's just a little corner, the last remaining corner in this house. And I'm doing my best here. But thanks for those kind words. And it's nice to meet you. Let's establish this first. How do we know each other?
Well, I started listening a lot more to the Humble and Fred podcast during COVID, and I worked with Fred way back when in the 80s.
Freddie P.
Fred Patterson. And so I started listening more, and then you would show up every Thursday, and then I started hearing, you know, different people from my past, coworkers, colleagues, friends,
right,
were showing up as FOTMs, and I'm thinking, I know that guy, I know that guy. And then I went on a binge listen. I went through, you sent me a link. I contacted you. I'm not sure what it was about.
Okay. I probably sent you to the notable guests
exactly.
page. Yes, which I maintain.
There was something happened, though, that I sent you an email to alert you of something that I had heard on a podcast, and I thought, you know what? Toronto Mike would be happy to know this. And I sent you an email.
Do you remember what it was?
I can't remember. It was somebody said something, and I said, you know, who also knows about that story is X, Y, or Z.
Okay.
And then you said something about... where are you? And I said, Vancouver. And you said, well, next time you're in Toronto, let me know.
Okay.
And we'll hook you up.
And I'm a man of my word.
And you are.
Because here you are. Okay. So you normally live in Vancouver.
Right.
How long you lived out west?
Since 2005.
It's a long time. Okay. Yeah. And you're going to die out there, right? You don't have no plans to move.
After 4 days of driving in this traffic, you will not see me living in this town again.
If you bought a bike, you would love it here.
I ride a bike everywhere in Vancouver.
Right.
That's
why you hate driving. It's like me. If I go somewhere on vacation or something and I got to drive everywhere.
This is me right now.
I suddenly hate it. But it's not that it's just because I don't have my bike.
Yeah.
I actually just hate the fact that I don't have my bike.
Yeah. No, that's it. I'm driving. I'll drive more this week visiting different people, visiting my mom. Then I'll drive most of this entire year.
So is this trip to Toronto, is this to visit your mom?
It's mostly, you know, that's the prime reason of coming out here is to visit my mom, who is in a long-term care facility. And I guarantee you she will never hear this. But she's in a long-term care facility, and I'm visiting her every day in the morning. And I'm probably going to stop and see her on the way downtown after this.
Because you're going to the Jays game.
I'm going to the Jays game tonight.
Okay, you're a good son.
I am the oldest and greatest, but that's debatable. My brother is doing the bulk of the heavy lifting right now because he lives here.
Right.
I did a lot of things for my mom when I was younger, and then I moved after she was healthy and everything was good. She gave me her blessings. I moved and I never looked back, but I come back once a year.
Okay, so much ground I want to cover. Firstly, we are going to kick out the jam. So fantastic. We're going to play 10 songs. We're going to talk about that. But also, along the way, the journey we're going to take, we're going to get to know you better. And you're connected. This is similar to last Friday when... No, two Fridays ago when Blair Packham dropped by because he said he had so many connections to FOTMs, he had to share them all. Mm-hmm. Coincidentally, one of them was to Andrew Crystal, who passed away the next day. So, you know...
I'm sad I never met that man.
You know...
Well, our paths didn't cross.
I liked him because he's a character and interesting, and I'm a big fan of interesting.
Yeah.
But he was also super fucking weird. So, I mean, I don't know. He's not everybody's cup of tea when you meet him in person. No. But
Neither am I, though.
Well, it's too early for me to judge, but I will let you know. But shout out to Ridley Funeral Home, pillars of this community since 1921. Okay. So from any time we mention a dead person, we'll do that. But and by the way, Mark Weisblatt's my guest on Thursday. So
I know.
A full memorial segment. Have you ever heard a Weisblatt episode of Trauma?
I listen to every one.
Okay.
Three hours each. And you have to make a commitment to that. But there's a guy I'd never heard of before. And all of a sudden I'm listening going, wow, this is a different type of guy. But it all, it's entertaining.
Yes.
And the
it's interesting, just like Crystal, interesting and entertaining.
And the shout outs to different various people, and he's right. Like an encyclopedia of stuff that I'm not aware of. So good for him.
Yeah, I bet you he would know your career without needing any help.
I would actually be shocked if he did.
Well, I'll find out Thursday.
We'll soon find out, won't we? Because I know he reviews your shows.
Yes.
Like he'll just drop in
Well, that's the thing. I mentioned that Blair Packham from two Fridays ago, but in that episode, Packham did a great Weisblatt impersonation.
That I can't do.
Went in depth into the Mark Weisblatt episode. So my feeling on the Weisblatt is that those who like that like it a lot because you don't get that anywhere else. Mm-hmm. The reason I give it 3 hours a month is because I personally love that. So here you go. The mic's open. Yeah. Go nuts. But this is the Hanafin, the 90 minutes of Mike Hanafin. And you, of course, I know you have notes there because you're always prepared.
Oh, yeah.
Did you want to start with an FOTM connection and then we'll start kicking out jams and then I'll play clips of you and we'll do different connections? What's the best approach for you?
I'll go with you. You're the running man of the show. But at the same time, I just finished having lunch with an FOTM.
Okay. Which FOTM did you have
Chris
lunch with?
Chris Mayberry.
Yes, Mabo.
Mabo. I just had finished just lunch and it was a good timing because I could review some of the old stories that we both were there for.
So you told him you were coming over.
I absolutely did.
He didn't have that pleasure.
He said hi on behalf of him. He said, just please tell Mike I said hi. And anybody else that might be out there that knows Chris, just a gem of a man.
Oh, it's what a small world. Okay, so of course, you can only have lunch. On this visit to visit your mom here in Toronto, you can only have lunch with FOTMs. Let's do this one off the top because I alluded to her yesterday when I had Torquil Campbell of the Stars on the program. And Torque, of course, he's a member of STARS, a founding member, which is one of Rosie Ferguson's favorite bands of all time. I went to high school with Rosie before she was a Ferguson. Let's begin by telling the FOTMs, how are you connected to the original co-host of Toronto Mike, Rosie?
Well, after the fame part of my career with the CFNY and different things like that and CFRB, I ended up going into TV in the background. I worked at TSN as a writer, producer, blah, blah, blah. I worked my way up the ladder. And then I left there to go work at the Weather Network as a writer, producer, news writer, producer. And Rosie worked at the Weather Network as a coordinator. She was like the most important person in that newsroom.
She was the straw that stirred the drink.
Everything went through Rosie. And Rosie and I hit it off immediately. I could make her laugh. She could make me laugh. And Rosie has a great laugh.
Yes.
And what I would do, I'd be, working away and typing something, and I would mutter something reasonably funny. And about 5 seconds later, in the office down the hall, Rosie would just burst out laughing. And we'd just have fun.
Yeah, but I groomed her to laugh at Mike's. Like,
there you go.
She was already kind of ready to laugh at
Mike's. I didn't know that. So now you've deflated my... But I'll tell you, one of my favorite Rosie stories was when she got engaged. Because she had been... Is it Rob, right?
No, it's Scott.
Scott, sorry. Sorry to all the Robs out there. But Scott...
Could have been a Rob.
She'd been dating. And anyway, so... I knew,
Yeah, they met at Ryerson now, really at Toronto Metropolitan University.
She really wanted to be engaged and everything. And one day, I'm in the office and I'm writing away, and the door opens, and a hand comes through the door
with a ring,
with this enormous rock.
Wow.
And it just, and this hand just sits there. And then she opens the door and everybody applauds.
Okay, you ready for a mind blow? You ready for a mind blow?
There you go.
So this the man who, you know, was lucky enough to marry Rosie, his name is Scott Ferguson. And you're connected to another FOTM, not that guy, but a guy named Scott Ferguson.
Yeah, Scott Ferguson was very important in the very early parts of my career because when I was at Humber, I astutely made connections with all the major sportscasters in the city as part of a project for Humber College, the radio program. And Scott, I interviewed him, and he thought, you know, you'd be a good guy to get in here to intern. So I became an intern at CKFH.
That's Foster Hewitt. Foster Hewitt,
the old CKFH. This would be about 1980.
Okay.
And I worked, I'd go in once or twice a week, and I would write the sportscasts, 30-second sportscasts for the newscasters to read at the end of their news.
Wow.
And I would write
that. And this is 1430?
1430. Right. And they would give me that little assignment, and I did okay.
Wow.
And then, so I did that. I was, and Scott took me to a few assignments. I was interning, and he showed me around. The thing about Scott was that he imparted on me the most was professionalism. That guy was a pro. He was professional, integrity. And he did everything the right way, and he taught me a lot of the things the right way. So anyway, that led to my first radio job, because I went in to intern one day, and I'm just in there, you know, interning, and Larry Silver was the news director. He says, hey, you, come here. And he calls me into his office, and he says, our telemedia station in Stratford has a junior newsman job open. Are you interested? I said, yes. And he says, he hands me the phone, and it's Doug Lester on the other end saying, blah, 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 blah. And are you interested in what's your background? Blah, blah, blah. And I had been a sportscaster on the radio stations in the college thing.
Right.
And so they said, well, come on out next Monday. We'll interview you. Drive out to Stratford. Drove out to Stratford, got the job, and I was in radio.
And you're, off and running. Lots of stuff there. Was Hebsey ever at CKFH? Or was he
not when I was there?
Oh, he was at when it was Metro 1430.
Yeah, I never was aware of Hebsey until Sportsline.
Until Sportsline. Gotcha. Okay, just trying to connect some dots to other FOTMs if I can. Sad news. I don't want to make it sound like he passed away. Still with us. Go, Scott, go. Yep. But Scott's not doing particularly well these days, I'm told. He did reveal on my show that he was battling. Yep. I think it's Parkinson's.
Yeah, I listened to that episode, and I was so happy to hear he was, you know, doing okay, but understanding that he did have some health concerns.
What is the term? Progressive. So this doesn't get better. It only gets
worse.
And
I hope he hears this, and I hope he hears a shout-out, because I admire the hell out of that guy.
The voice of my youth, along with Tom and Jerry, was Scott Ferguson.
Oh, yeah.
And by the way, are you friendly with, we've lost the great Tom Cheek, of course, but you friendly with Jerry Howarth?
I'll send him a note every once in a while, but I'll tell you a great story about Jerry Howarth.
Yeah.
I'm in Stratford,
okay,
and I'm, you know, junior newsman, sportscaster, and I'm doing baseball games, the local senior baseball team.
Is that where the Toronto Maple Leafs play?
Exactly.
International Baseball League.
Exactly.
Yes. Okay.
And it was the Stratford Hillers.
Okay.
And so I got to do play-by-play and color with an older guy named Clark Heyman.
Okay.
He was the local yokel sportscaster. You know, every town has one, and he was it.
Like Les Nessman?
way louder.
You. Right.
Like Clark didn't need this microphone. He was easily heard.
Right.
Anyway, Clark was fantastic. But anyway, so Clark and I did the games, and I sent a reel-to-reel of a tape to Jerry. Just an air check.
Okay.
And Jerry sent me a detailed analysis typed with complete, ending by ending analysis of what was good, what needed work, this, that, and the other thing. And you know, the kindest man you could ever ask for.
What a sweetheart.
Unbelievable. And then I thanked him profusely, and it turned out I was not cut out for that kind of thing, but it was still a great experience. And then years later, I'm back in Toronto and in the same press box as Jerry Howarth.
Okay, so let's get you to CFNY here before we kick out your first jam.
Sure.
How do you get the gig at CFNY?
And again, kudos to Fred on this one. But
FOTM Fred Patterson.
But I'm also not without some smarts. So I'm in Stratford, and I have every other weekend off, and I decided I would come back to the city to see mom and see friends. And But one year, the Argos were playing. This would be 83, the fall of 83.
Oh, okay.
And
they won
Argos,
the Grey Cup in 83.
But yeah, but it was probably the fall of 83, near the end of the season. So I had a weekend off and I arranged to get a press pass to go and sit in the Argo press box. So I go and I'm walking down the corridor behind an exhibition stadium in the football press box. Yeah. And walking towards me is Fred Patterson. And I knew Fred. Fred
from
knew
his mustache.
Me from when I was in college and I had introduced myself and made him aware of me.
Okay.
He sees me and he goes, "Oh, Mike, great to see you. Listen, we just got approved to hire a sportscaster in March.
Wow.
So get me a tape." And I went, "Oh, but I just happened to have a tape." And I reached into my pocket and I handed him a cassette.
Always be prepared.
Always be prepared. Handed him a cassette. And he was kind of taken aback by it, but whatever. He took the cassette. I had two in my pockets in case. You know, you never know. But I gave him one, and I got a phone call the next Monday. "We love your tape. I want you to record the next time you are on the air," which was 12:30 sports on Monday that day. "Record that and send it to me. Courier it. We'll pay for it." And I did. And I got a call from him like 3 or 4 days later saying, "When are you back in town?" I said, in a week or 2 weeks, my weekend off. "Next time you're coming, stop by the radio station. We want to talk to you. Marsden wants to talk to you."
Marsden.
And so I got more dressed up than I normally would. And I drove straight to the house on Kennedy Road.
Right.
The building.
The strip mall.
They had moved in over Spanky's or whatever the heck it was underneath. And I got an audience with David Marsden and Fred, and it went well. And, you know, I was a fan of the station. I knew the station. I knew the...
We're in about 84?
This would be the fall of 83 still.
Okay, gotcha.
And then I remember sitting there, and we were talking about this and that and the other thing, and Marsden turns to Fred and goes, "I like that guy." He didn't say it that way. I can't do a David Marsden imitation.
"I like that.
I like that guy.
Dave Mars. Bar.
I think we should hire him." And Fred said, "That's it." And it was done. And I started in March of 84.
Okay, let's hear a little bit of you on CFNY.
Yep.
"Would have been asked for a saliva test a month ago if you had predicted the Leafs would be within two games of sweeping a series to reach the NHL semifinals. But sometimes truth is stranger than fiction, and the word sweep has started springing up. No question, if the Leafs keep getting unbelievable goaltending from Ken Reggett, if their power play and penalty-killing units continue to play so well, and if they play with the same discipline they showed in Game 2, then maybe, just maybe, the Leafs can take it. Stranger things have happened, but not many." Leaf forward Steve Thomas is a bit reluctant to admit it, but he is thinking sweet.
"I don't know. It's still going to be tough. There's still two tough games left, and they're a very physical team. And I think going back to Toronto and our home fans, and it's going to be great. Like, our home fans are unbelievable now, and I think we have an edge, and there's a possibility we could go four straight."
With the Leafs, this is Mike Hanafin, CFNY Sports.
And my first reaction is, what an idiot. Because that was in Detroit. That was a playoff series, I think 86 or 87. And they went into Detroit and won the first two games.
Right.
And then they start, and they were talking sweep. We didn't talk sweep. They were talking sweep.
No one talks sweep when you're
nobody
up 2-0.
Nobody does that. And they did, and they lost in seven. And they didn't, I don't think they scored a goal in the last three games or two games.
Right.
And I remember Brophy was the coach, and Brophy was trying
to... He was going to Jack Demers, right? That's that series. This is a famous exchange they have on the benches.
They hated each other.
Yes. Okay.
But Brophy's trying to keep them calm, like, don't talk sweep. You're idiots. They got all these good players.
I think we swept... This is back in the first round at that time. It was a best of five, not a best of seven. Yep. And we swept the Blackhawks in three. And then we went, we went seven games of Detroit. Yeah. I think we got beat.
What an unbelievable series. And this will lead to something a little later on when we kick out the jams.
Okay, awesome. So maybe get you out of CFNY, then get to the first jam. Here I am just towing you along here.
Because there's lots more CFNY.
Why do you leave CFNY in 88? And then we'll just tell more CFNY stories as we go.
So I have my 4 years at CFNY, and I having a great time. I'm 24 when I started there.
Right.
I'm way too immature, but, you know, they took a chance, and Fred, again, took a chance on me and gave me lots of leeway. I started on weekends, I did weekend sports, and I was a reporter 3 days a week. And then Fred started thinking, well, you know what? I don't want to do a split shift anymore, because he was doing mornings and afternoons. So he convinced somebody there that I could do afternoons 3 days a week. So I started doing the afternoons with James Baby Scott.
The late great.
The late great. Rest in peace. And so I did the afternoons, I think Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and then all day Saturday, Sunday with another person who's just passed away, Peter Goodwin.
Wow, okay.
He was the newscaster.
And his wife was just on episode 1021, right? Yeah, Liz Janik.
Yeah, such a nice person.
Okay, so where do I go with this? Did you know working with James Baby Scott that that was David Marsden's
brother?
Yes,
I did, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I never knew what was known when. And,
everybody there, it was such an unbelievable place to work because everybody's different. There's people coming from all over the place. And I'm sports. I'm like the lowest... you know, on the totem pole, although I was immature enough to think I was, you know, more important than I was, but everybody was so welcoming and so supportive. Like I would do the sports with James Scott on his show.
Right.
And he was just right into it. And he was so encouraging and different things like that. And I also got to work with Pete and Geets when Fred would go on vacation.
So Fred wasn't there because he had his vacation time. Yep. You would do sports. Would you do it with Mike Stafford?
Yes.
So he'd do news.
Yeah.
So tell me a little bit, like, what was it like? What was Mike Stafford like back then?
Well,
then tell me about Pete and Geets.
Mike Stafford may have been the most intelligent person I've ever met when it talks about, you know, talking about brain power, different, just such
he's a smart guy.
Unbelievably talented person who could do voices and do this and do that. He used to make all those fake phone calls in pretending he was British or pretending he was something else.
Right.
And, but Mike also knew how to crack me up. He cracked me up on the air one time. I'm doing the sports and he's sitting in the booth next to me and Woody Hayes, the former legendary Ohio State football coach who was fired for punching an opposing player. He got fired, famously.
Okay.
He passes away that morning. And somebody hands me the BN copy, that, you know, legendary coach, right near the end of my sportscast, and I read it. And as I'm reading, you know, I just got this in, you know, legendary sports or football coach, you know, Woody Hayes has passed away, and Stafford pretends to punch me. And I cracked up reading an obit.
Wow. Yeah, well, shout out to Ridley Funeral Home. That's a tough time to crack up.
It was not my finest hour, but that's the kind of thing Mike liked to do. He liked to get people to laugh, sometimes uncomfortably, but it was still fun.
Now, I never met Pete. He passed away before I could start this project, but I did meet Geets. Why don't you tell us about Pete and Geets?
Yeah, again, super welcoming. I'm nobody, right? And they have me come into their show. They do a thing every morning at 8:10.
Yeah.
They used to call it the 8:10 Sports Floater, where Fred would come in and just, you know, shoot the shit with about the Jays or the Leafs or whatever. Right. And they just talk about different things. And they would have me do that. And I remember one time they got sidetracked with some other thing going on. And I went in and then nothing happened. They just waved me away like, okay. So I go back to my desk and I'm typing away to get ready for my 8:30 sportscast, and the phone rings.
Yeah.
And it's Pete. He says, and I answered, and I went, oh, is this the 8:10 sports floater? And they laughed, and they cracked up laughing. But yeah, Pete was fantastic. He was such a pro and such a magical broadcaster at just creating this aura and everything else. And Pete and Geets were such a pair. They also caught on early that I had a hair trigger laugh. And so Geets one time decided he was going to crack me up on the air. And because this is not a PG rated show.
No, you can swear.
I can tell this story.
Tell it.
So I'm reading my sportscast and Geets is standing in front of the little window and he's pretending to
masturbate
to himself. And he's trying to get me to laugh. So I put my head, my eyes down, and I got my hands over. I'm trying to shield. Don't look, don't look, don't look. And then I just peeked up and Geets had taken a glass of water and sprayed it on the window. And I just lost it.
Sure.
And that made their day.
Did you listen to them when they were on Chum FM?
Absolutely. So I was in awe. I got to work on the same air, like after listening to them for such a long time.
Wow.
I'm working with Pete and Geets. Wow. And like I was like part of the family. It was amazing.
Okay, so in 1988, I actually have this audio.
Yes. What happened in 87, late 87, Fred calls me in and he says, listen, they're cutting all the budget and they're completely blowing out the newsroom and you're going to be laid off. And so I said, oh, you know, that's devastating. I just bought a condo. I wasn't making a ton of money anyway. But anyway, so, but Fred.
How much were you making?
Probably,
statute of limitations.
Probably 18.
18. Okay. Maybe. I'm going to find out. What was a bag of milk at that time?
Whatever. Okay, so anyway, but to his credit, and again, Fred, fantastic. He said, I am not happy about this. This is ridiculous, blah, 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 blah. He says, here's what we can do.
Yeah.
You can take 4 months severance right now, a check, or you can stay on the air for four more months to March 31st, and we'll pay you. We'll help you with tapes. We'll help you with this and that. And I said, I'll take the 4 months.
Yeah.
Because I got to stay on the air.
Right.
It was like a four-month audition tape for anybody else that wanted to, you know, maybe hire me, which turned out to lead to my next job. But anyway, okay. So what you have is my final broadcast.
Okay. Now, I like these old, like, I like listening to a sports cast from 1988. Like, I enjoyed hearing that, you know, will they sweep up to nothing? So I'm going to, it's longer than, you know, I'm going to play it in its entirety because I dig it.
It's, in those days, I could do a 4.5 minute sports cast.
Unbelievable when you think about it. And that's, I mean, this is my, you know,
nobody
I was
does that
to.
Anymore.
No. But let's listen to how you sounded in March 1988.
And here with sports, Mike Hanafin, a presentation of Labatt's Blue.
Well, Rick, the Blue Jays were whipped 8-2 by Pittsburgh today at Dunedin in what was supposed to be their final game in Florida. However, the weekend games in Denver are now a question mark. It snowed in Denver last night. The Jays were supposed to play two games there against Minnesota at Mile High Stadium. If the weather in Denver doesn't improve, then the Jays and Twins will play Saturday and Sunday in Orlando, Florida. There's also an intra-squad game tomorrow morning at Grant Field. Todd Stottlemyre will pitch against Syracuse. If Stottlemyre doesn't pitch well, those could be his new teammates. The Jays still have to cut one more pitcher before opening day. In today's game, John Cerutti was roughed up for 7 hits, 6 runs in just 4 innings, and Bob Shirley finally gave up his first run of the spring in relief. Not much to cheer about for Jays fans. George Bell played left field, drove in his 13th run of the spring, tops on the club, and rookie catcher Pat Borders went 3-for-4. The Leafs are in Detroit as we speak, probably just arrived, and Miroslav Friedcher is with the team. Friedcher showed up at practice this morning after going missing yesterday for personal reasons, says Friedcher. John Brophy says Friedcher has been fined today's pay but will dress for the final two games of the season against Detroit tomorrow and Saturday night. However, you can bet if Brophy is still with the Leafs next year, Friedcher won't be. Biggest game of the night in the NHL, New Jersey at Pittsburgh, the loser out of the playoff race. The winner moves into a tie with the Rangers for the final playoff spot in the Patrick. Former world snooker champ Cliff Thorburn of Toronto faces
snooker
a heavy
news.
Fine and lengthy suspension.
Wow. A big story.
Even a possible lifetime suspension after testing positive for cocaine at a tournament last month in Britain. You don't want to bury the man, but already fellow Canadian Kirk Stevens has had his career ruined by coke. The stench surrounding professional boxing in Ontario continues to get worse. Today, the Ontario government relieved Clyde Gray of his duties as Ontario Athletics Commissioner, reassigned him. This after Gray admitted to letting as many as 40 unlicensed or underage boxers fight in Ontario over the last few years. Gray, a former pro boxer and a good one, admitted to bending the rules a little bit to help keep boxing alive in the province. Good intentions, say some, but the government says the safety of boxers should be their primary objective, not keeping the sport alive, and there are many people who don't think the sport should be kept alive at the pro or amateur level. The Ottawa Rough Riders have signed quarterback Art Schliester. The former Ohio State All-American was kicked out of the NFL 2 years ago for repeated gambling incidents. Just yesterday, he filed for bankruptcy with reported debts of almost $1 million. But apparently, Schliester has kicked the gambling habit and will try to resurrect his career in the CFL. Coming out of university, Schliester looked like the perfect CFL quarterback, good passer, and even better runner. The Riders, of course, need all the help they can get. And at 5:41, that's sports for Labatt's Blue, my final sports cast at CFNY after 4 years. Whatever the circumstances, I enjoyed doing the sports here. I hope you enjoyed listening to me. Hopefully you will hear me or see me somewhere very soon, whether after this.
And now, Blue Jays Fever, brought to you by the...
So now, a little funny thing about that sportscast. Now, normally, the newscaster, Rick Charles, who's the news director, would leave the booth while I was doing the sports and then come back well after the commercial. He stayed in the booth the whole time I was there, and it unnerved me a bit near the middle because I thought he was staying there in case I might say something.
Oh.
And I didn't say anything untoward. I just did, you know.
Well, you don't want to burn bridges.
No, of course not.
You're a young man.
No,
yeah.
Professional and everything else. But he stayed in the booth. And I was like, he never stayed in the booth. So I really think he was waiting. He was just ready to, you know, in case I said something like, oh, screw this, take this job or whatever and burn down the building.
Wow.
No,
okay.
No chance it would do that.
That's a fun fact right there. All right, my friend. So on this note, before you end up at CFRB and we have some more stuff to talk about, could we kick out a jam?
Sure.
Now, you sent him in an order of a list. I play it from top to bottom, right?
You can do anything you want.
Oh, okay. Well, then I'm going to play it from top to bottom.
You mentioned Detroit. And if you want to go the...
Oh, I know which one to do. Okay. So a band from Detroit you want me to play?
No.
Oh.
No. Public Enemy.
Okay.
I have a story about this.
Well, let's do this.
To
okay. So Mike Hanafin, are you ready to kick out the jam?
I am. Definitely.
My band right here.
And you got to interview Chuck D.
It's hard to listen to this without rhyming over it, but I'm going to show some great restraint.
Turn up the radio. They're claiming I'm a criminal. But now I wonder how. Some people never know. The enemy could be the Frank Guardian. I'm now a hooligan. I rock the party and clear all the madness. I'm not a racist. Preach to teach the officer.
Cause something never had this.
Number one, never wanna run about the gun. I wasn't licensed to have one. The minute they see me, fear me. I'm the epitome of public enemy. Used, abused without clues. I refuse to blow a fuse. They even had it on the news.
Don't believe the hype. Don't believe the hype. Don't believe the hype.
Shout out to FOTM Chuck D.
Chuck,
talk to me.
You interviewed Chuck D. Just blew my mind. That was awesome. I met Flavor Flav in Detroit in that playoff series in an elevator.
Wow.
I'm waiting for the elevator to go down to the lobby for breakfast, and the elevator opens, and there are two people in the elevator. This tall gentleman, black gentleman in a three-piece suit and a briefcase, and Flavor Flav. And I see him, and I'm the whitest guy in Detroit. And it opens up, and I go, Flavor Flav!
Right.
And he's like, oh my God.
Did he have a clock?
And I
neck?
Asked him.
Okay.
I asked him. I Flavor Flav. Oh my! And he's like, I said, Flav, where's your clock? And he goes, and I can't do an imitation that well. Oh no, man, that's my stage gear.
Right.
He wasn't wearing a clock.
Okay, so I am told I have 20 minutes of Chuck D, but I got to get my ass to the CNE band shell. So I actually put all of my studio in a
amazing
box. I put it in my bike trailer. I biked to the CNE grounds. I set up in a room in the back, okay? By the way, shout out to Mishy Me, who was on the stage that I watched Mishy Me with her DJ, who's also a FOTM DJ. Nice. Okay. Now, but 1 minute before I'm going to start recording with Chuck D, which might as well, it'd be like if you told Freddie P he was getting an interview with Paul McCartney, okay? That's what we're talking about here. The woman he worked with, I don't know if she was a PR person or what, but she says to me, okay, you can ask him anything, but you can't ask about Flavor Flav, okay? Yep. Of course I'm going to ask about Flavor Flav, but now I've got this rule, which I don't really work this way. You told me I didn't have any rules. I don't work with rules. So now I've got 20 minutes with Chuck D, and I can't ask him the big question I want to ask him. Where's Chuck? Because he was there with Public Enemy Radio, because Chuck D was, I mean, sorry,
exactly.
Flavor Flav wasn't there.
Yep.
Okay. Long story short is I found a way to get him to introduce the Flavor Flav question. So
you're an expert.
Yeah. But that's a one shot. You got 20 minutes, which I'm used to having like 90 minutes.
You interviewed Chuck D.
I know. It was great.
Holy
I loved it so much. And I know he wanted, I think we started talking Raptors at the end because he's a big NBA guy.
Yeah.
And
great.
Raptors had just won the championship. And then I got the sign from the same woman. This wrap-up sign, and I'm like, but he wants to talk to me. I was like, lady, he wants to talk to me. But anyway, I loved it.
Chuck D.
I love this song. I love this album. Me and Kareem, my neighbor, were blasting Public Enemy just this past weekend outside. And again, I'm listening to that, and I know every lyric from this song. Don't believe the hype from It Takes a Nation of Millions to Hold Us Back.
And I'm the whitest guy ever, but I love this stuff. And
people love Public Enemy.
Oh, yeah. And maybe later on we'll hear some other stuff. But Public Enemy is just awesome. Driving music. And it's not driving music for everybody. For me, I love putting this on when I'm driving.
Yeah, and I like putting on Public Enemy when I'm biking. But I always stick to the first four albums. So I like Yo Bum Rush the Show, even though no one ever talks about it. I love that album. It Takes a Nation of Millions and Fear of a Black Planet are two of the greatest hip-hop albums in the history of the world. But I also love Apocalypse 91, The Enemy Strikes Black. So.
And I am not an encyclopedia of Public Enemy. My friend Caleb, back in Vancouver, who put me on to the depth of, you know, the whole thing. And so I owe a lot to him about my interest
shout
in this.
Shout him out.
Yep.
Yeah, shout out
Caleb
everyone
Trot.
Early and often. Okay, so we're going to let Flav take us home here, and then I'm going to roll right into another one of your jams, which is very different.
Very.
Don't worry, Flav and Vision ain't blurry. You know what I'm saying? Don't terminate.
What a band. And it's such a great CFNY band. I saw them when I was in college all the time. They played every pub that I was ever at.
Wow.
And the Blind Duck, the Humber College pub, they played it all over the place. And they had a legion of followers. And then they were on CFNY. And it was just like so great. And then I remember as a kid calling Chum FM constantly. There was a campaign to get them on Chum FM. And Chum FM resisted and resisted. Wouldn't play their first album.
Right.
When they started, they played their second album, and they tried to call it a debut album. They wouldn't play their first album, and the first album was awesome.
Wow.
And then I saw, you know, and I ended up seeing the band in 2008 in Vancouver. And one of the greatest nights ever for me, I saw Rush at the arena play their tour, Snakes and Ladders tour, and then up the street at the Vogue or wherever it was, the Review, Teenage Head. Back-to-back that night, and I had a chance to talk to Gordy Lewis during the intermission. Talked to him. I introduced myself, and he remembered who I was from CFNY, and I never forget. He goes, I said I'd gone to the Rush, and he says, oh, Rush played tonight? Oh, too bad they couldn't come up and watch us. And I'm like, yeah, Rush is not coming to the Review.
No, but they'll go to the Jays game, and
Absolutely.
He's Geddy Lee will be there.
And again, just we'll play some Rush in a little bit. But I saw two bands, and then shortly after that, Frankie Venom passed away.
Right. Oh, my goodness. Okay. Love it. Love the variety we're getting here off the bat. A couple of jams deep, eight more great ones to go. But so when you leave CFNY, how did you get the gig at CFRB?
Well, I'd been heard. They knew I was a kind of a known quantity. And almost immediately I get a phone call from Fred Locking, one of their sportscasters, saying, listen, you're going to be available. We've got some, reporting stuff. Like there's some Jays games we can't cover with our staff. They had four sportscasters and we don't have, enough people because CFRB was doing sports morning, afternoon, evening.
Can you name the four?
It was, Bill Stevenson.
Yes.
Dave Quinn, Fred Locking, and Pat Marsden. In those days.
Really?
Yeah, Pat Marsden was he would do afternoons. Stevenson would do the mornings. And then Quinn and Fred Locking split the evenings and then weekends also. And so, there were all these Jays games that had to be covered.
Quinn just passed away, right?
Quinn passed away just recently.
Like this month.
Yes. And what an unbelievably fantastic guy. And I'm so sad that he passed away. He was such a funny, funny, funny man. His sense of humor never really totally made it to the air. He was way funnier off the air, but he was still funny.
I'm sure. I'm certain he'll be referenced again in the Ridley Funeral Home Memorial segment
on Thursday.
And the
pipes. Oh, my God. He just, he boomed the crap out of anybody in the room.
But back to, just for a moment, Pat Marsden.
Yep.
he would then, I guess several years later, would show up at the Fan 590 yeah. with John Derringer.
Oh, yeah.
Any news about him lately?
I seem to remember somebody saying something about him.
That might also come up
him.
On Thursday.
That'll probably come up. Very much a, what a
Did you
mess.
Ever meet him?
John, yes. Oh, yeah. He would show up in the press box every once in a while, and he was very nice to me. But, my rule is I believe women. I believe the women. End of that period and stop. And
full stop. Okay.
Full stop.
Do you want to hear a little of yourself on CFRB doing evening
sure.
sports
so,
in
so,
Feb 89?
Yeah, it evolved. I was doing a lot of reporting on Jays games, and I would call in voicers and pregame voicers and this and that. And then, you know, occasionally when people would be on vacation, they would need somebody to read, because CFRB did sportscasts every hour in the evenings, and I would do that, and I managed to find a tape the other day, and there's a friend of mine is introducing me as the newscaster.
Okay, this is from February 1989.
Yep.
9:33.
5 minutes after nine, and here with sports is Mike Hanafin.
Thanks, Erica, and good evening, everyone. Four games in the NHL tonight. Buffalo leads Winnipeg 3-1 in the second period. Also in the second, Philadelphia leads New Jersey 2-1. Later, it's St. Louis at Calgary and Los Angeles at Edmonton. The Leafs wind up their four-game road trip tomorrow night at Minnesota. The CFL has awarded the 1991 Grey Cup game to Winnipeg, the same city that drew only 12,000 fans for a playoff game in 1988.
We say
the
that
CFL
now.
Also approved the sale of the Hamilton Ticats to businessman David Braley. Michaela Fagini won today's World Cup downhill at Aspen, top Canadian Karen Percy in sixth. Mike Tyson and Frank Bruno weighed in today for tomorrow's heavyweight championship fight in Las Vegas. Tyson came in 218, Bruno tipped the scales at 228. And a report from New York says Olympic star Florence Griffith Joyner will announce her retirement tomorrow. FloJo won 3 gold medals in Seoul and has been raking in the dough ever since. I'm Mike Hanafin. I'll have another sports update next hour. Erica?
Thanks, Mike. This is
that. Oh, who's
is
Erica?
Erica Johnson.
Okay.
Who is was the host of Marketplace on CBC.
Okay.
She and now I think she goes works for Go Public, another kind of consumer advocate or you know, kind of digging in the corporate world to find skullduggery. And Erica and I are still friends.
Okay, good.
And she was you know, a young person coming out of school and reading the news on CFRB, and I got to help her a little bit because she had to read the sports on weekends sometimes, like the little 10-second sport or 1-minute sportscast like right. that. And they actually asked me to come in and help, you know, kind of help her with the sports because she didn't know anything about sports. And we had a great time. We're still friends.
Now, they referenced one of your, you mentioned FloJo in your, and it's funny because this morning, Donovan Bailey was sitting in the seat you're sitting in right now, and he likes to talk track, obviously, that on his podcast. And FloJo came up. We were talking about world records, and FloJo came up. And you have a connection to Donovan?
Well, not a connection, but it was one of the career highlights involved Donovan Bailey.
Okay.
This comes up in 1996 when I'm working at TSN.
Okay, so let's do this then. Yeah. I want to, let me kick it another jam, and then we'll hear a little more CFRB Hanafin, and then post-CFRB we'll capture that you know, that Atlanta 96 story here. But one of my favorite bands of all time is on your list. So would you mind if I kick it out?
I'd do it.
Woo!
Now, this intro is just unbelievable. The first time I saw this on Saturday Night Live, I was like, what the hell is this? And then I just melted. Notice I don't try to sing.
still alive. How do you resist with that jam? Okay.
I've done it, but I wouldn't do it in public.
Talk to me about I almost said Public Enemy, but no. Pearl Jam.
Pearl Jam, like one of my favorite bands of all time. I saw them on Saturday Night Live. My cousin, who lives, my late cousin, who just passed away recently.
My condolences.
He used to, in Vancouver, he used to hear the Seattle stations and would hear this, and he notified me, something. You got to hear this band, Pearl Jam. You got to hear this band, Nirvana. You got to hear this band, you know, all and all down the list. And I see them on Saturday Night Live, and I was just blown away. Now, what I would consider the expert on Pearl Jam is FOTM Alan Cross. And Alan Cross did a deep, deep, deep dive, maybe one of many, about how this song and how that band was formed out of the Mother Love Bone remnants.
Yes, sir.
And Eddie Vedder is sitting on a beach in San Diego with lyrics, and Stone Gossard and the band are in Seattle with music, and they send a tape, a cassette tape, and Vedder overdubs some words to this song over top of that cassette and sends it back to Stone Gossard, and Gossard gets the tape and he's like calling his bandmates and going, you gotta come over right now and hear this. And it was just, it was mind-blowing.
Can you name the band that he was in at the time in San Diego?
Oh, God.
We can help you.
No, sorry.
Bad Radio.
Bad Radio, yep.
Yeah, and they wanted to be called Mookie Blaylock at first.
Yeah, well, yeah, they tried that, and then Mookie Blaylock sent them a cease and desist, didn't he?
But they named the album 10, because that was Mookie's number. Yeah. So.
Well, plus there was 10 songs.
I'm going to do, yeah, if you say so, but great, great song. Oh,
one of the best.
And you're right. I mean, that band comes out of Mother Love Bone. Well, three of them, anyways, come out of Mother, Jeff and Stone. And I think, they add the guy from The Shadows, and then MacReady.
And then they picked up MacReady.
Yeah, MacReady's from The Shadows. Yep. And then you got Bad Radio's San Diego Surfer, Ed Vedder. And it, perfect. Boom. And yeah, I mean, we talked about how much I love Public Enemy, but I just as much loved Pearl Jam.
This list is a combination of bands that I absolutely have loved in different eras, but also bands that I have some connection or a funny story or some kind of personal
thing.
Okay, I
love it. Love stories, man. Tell me a story. Okay, so here, because I know this song goes, it's got a nice jam in the middle too. And when you see them live, which I've done a dozen times or so, this song might take 20 minutes because this jam part,
I think it's 5:40.
Yeah, the studio track, yeah. Okay, so what I want to say really quickly here is I know you're visiting from Vancouver and you're off to the Jays game. So I don't know how convenient this would be for you. It might not be convenient at all. But guests who come in person to appear on Toronto Mic'd, they receive, this is like a Monty Hall or something, they receive a frozen lasagna from Palma Pasta.
Bring it on.
Okay, meat or veggie?
Meat.
Okay, this is a rare time I have both in the freezer. So you're not leaving without your meat lasagna. I have fresh craft beer from Great Lakes Brewery.
Please.
Delicious. Okay, you're getting beer. You're getting pasta.
That's why I rented a car.
You've got a here. Let me get you a Toronto Mike sticker. This is courtesy
sticker
of
you.
StickerU.com.
I've listened to a few shows.
Yeah, you know the drill. I should have you just do this. Well, but we've already shouted out the good people at Ridley Funeral Home. I'm not wearing my doer pants right now, but here's the deal. And this is really happening. On Friday, I'm moderating a panel at this conference called O Cannabis. And it's at the... by the airport. It's, where is it? International Center, one of those. I have to find out where I'm going. But I'm going to bike over in my doer pants, and then I'm going to moderate this panel, so I'm going to look fly, I'm going to look great. And I can bike in these pants, and it's going to be amazing. Doer, D-U-E-R, online or in the retail store on Queen Street. Use the promo code TMDS, and you can save 15% on the world's most comfortable pants and shorts. Oh, see that?
Okay. You've done this before.
That's a jam, my friend. Okay, now I want to bring us back to when the Blue Jays clinched the pennant in 1991.
Yes. One of the kind of the pinnacle things that you do in your career is cover a World Series game-winning home run.
Yeah, but this is not that, because this is the clincher in 91.
Oh, this is the previous one. Yes, I did send you
that. We don't actually get to the World Series this year, but I will say as an avid, and just, by the way, I don't know if you care about the Expos, and even if you have...
Oh, I was a huge Expos
fan. You have to hear the deep dive I did of Danny Gallagher.
When I get home, I will be listening to that.
Expos fans tell me that it belongs in St. Mary's in the Canadian Baseball Hall
of Fame. The Stonetown.
That's how good this is. Is that they call that Stonetown?
So St. Mary's is a Stonetown.
Okay, I should have known that.
It's
okay.
Just south of Stratford.
Yes. Yes. When I go to Grand Bend, when I go to Pinery, I usually drive right by it. Okay. Yeah. So this is, again, we won the AL East in 85. Mm-hmm. We won it again in 89 because we were supposed to win in 87, but we all know what happened there.
And that was the 89 was the Cito year.
Right.
They were 12 and 24. 20,
you got it, buddy.
Yeah. And I was there that day. Mookie, I was there that day.
Mookie comes in.
Yeah.
Oh, I have that too. So let's do that first. What were you doing for NPR in 1989?
Well, I was a freelancer. I was working for CFRB, but I was really never on staff. I was a freelancer.
Okay.
So I created my own company and just, you know, whatever.
Okay,
and
so
I
would work for different people. Let's do that then. Let's start with your NPR voicer
NPR
when they clinch in 89, and then we'll do CFRB in 91.
Yeah, okay. The NPR called me out of the blue and said, we'd like you to do something on this series.
Let's
and
hear
I
that.
Did for it.
Here we go.
One. The choker label has haunted the Jays since they lost the last seven games of the 1987 season to hand the division to Detroit. No fold-up this year, in fact, just the opposite, as Toronto came from behind with three runs in the eighth inning to beat Baltimore 4-3, clinching the division with one game left to play. Veteran reliever Tom Hinkie recorded the save and is glad to have it clinched before Sunday.
It's more of an advantage physically because you're going to rest our top frontline players, give them just a little extra rest.
There's something
that
about an awkward
well-deserved. And, you know, mentally, too, you can get back and you can relax a bit. We're in it now, and I think the fun starts now. The pressure's off.
I met him a few
years
ago.
After a nothing game today, the Jays head west to open the American League Championship Series Tuesday in Oakland. For National Public Radio, Mike Hanafin reporting.
Whoa. Good job.
That was a nice side gig, and they paid well. American dollars. No. Got to take that while you can.
Amazing. And so Tom Hanke is a nice guy.
Oh, the greatest guy. He's a total pro. And I was talking to Mabo about this earlier, about how... Yeah. How professional he was and how he mentored a lot of the newer players coming up. Like, I saw him because I work, well, we'll get to that in a bit, but I work for the Vancouver Canadiens now, the Jays farm team. I'm the official scorer. So they bring in all the old ex-Jays, and a few years ago they brought in Hanky, awesome. And Hanky sees me, and he's like, what are you doing here? Like,
amazing.
He recognizes me. And we talked about the old days, and I remember how I gave him a compliment. I said, you know, you were so good, like, win or lose. I remember one game specifically, he gave up a grand slam home run to Marco McGuire, to lose the game. And after the game, you're figuring everybody's going to be hiding. He'd be, you know, in the shower. He wouldn't be available. He was standing in front of his locker, and he says, ask me anything. Now, that's a pro. And so I tell him that story, and he goes, oh, yeah, that was the only Grand Slam I ever gave up in my entire professional career.
Wow.
And he remembered that day, too. But, see, the other players would see that.
Yeah.
Your Jimmy Keys, your Dwayne Wards, and your others that came along after him, and they would see that, and they would be professional.
Right. Well, like, Dwayne Ward particularly, who was completely mentored, and he was the setup guy,
absolutely.
The eighth inning guy
that
until 93.
One of the greatest setup closer combos in baseball history.
What a time. Okay.
If they were ahead in the going into the eighth inning, the game was over.
Right. Right. Oh, man, what great teams we had. Okay. So actually, now I'm just going to tease it. So we're going to, you know, go back to Detroit here. We're going to play a jam. Mm-hmm. I love this song so much, by the way. And then we're going to come back and we're going to hear that CFRB voicer you did when we clinched in 91. Okay. Mm-hmm. Let's hear this.
Another band that I saw for the first time on SNL and blew me away.
It's a fact that I'm the seventh son. It's quite possible that I'm your third man, girl. But it's a fact that I'm the seventh son. And right now you could care less about me. But soon enough you will care by the time I'm done. Let's have a ball and a biscuit, sugar, and take our sweet little time about it.
the ball, girl. And take our sweet little time about it.
White Stripes are so fucking good. Is it even, it might be possible, is it even possible they might be underappreciated, White Stripes, even though they were like...
You know, people slagged on Meg all the time, but there's no, you can't slag on this soul, this guitar solo. That's one guitar.
Well, he's a fucking genius, a musical genius.
Ridiculous. Have you heard, did you see them, him on Saturday Night Live when he filled in for Morgan, whatever his name is,
Oh, you know what? I did not see that.
He did a COVID version of this song.
Okay.
With COVID lyrics. And go find it on YouTube.
Jack White.
Saturday Night Live, Jack White appearance. And it was mesmerizing. Blew the stage up. Like, just
amazing.
Completely blew it up.
No, big fan. Big fan of all their stuff. And one of my favorite bands. So you just, so this is another band you discovered on SNL.
I had heard of them. And then I saw them on SNL, and it was like, oh my God, and I just bought everything they ever had.
I think the first big jam, I mean, that first album, I didn't hear it much, but CFNY would play Fell in Love with a Girl.
Yeah.
And they'd play it early and often.
And Much Music played a lot of their videos, too.
Yeah, well, yeah, from then on, basically. Yeah. But that's like, that was the mainstream breakthrough for this band.
Yeah, they did their first two albums. He basically, you know, did them himself and didn't have much radio play at all.
Prince style.
Yep. And then all of a sudden this hit and everybody went nuts. Well, this was actually off Elephant.
Yeah. No, it was
Dead Leaves
in
Dirty
you,
Ground.
But it was the Fell in Love with a Girl, I feel, sure. Because at that time you had that big The stuff going on. Like you had the Strokes, the Hives, like there were all the bands, and then you had the White Stripes in the mix.
Yeah,
there.
Because of that song, they got signed for the third album.
Amazing.
And then everything took off.
Great fucking band, great
jam.
Find
it on YouTube, that SNL appearance, the latest one. And then, of course, the last tour they did was Canada.
Every province, right?
Every province, every major city, some small cities. And they also did, you're probably aware, they did free concerts every day in buses, PEI they did in a harbor on a boat. They went to a bowling alley in Winnipeg or someplace like that. I can't remember now. They went to a community center in Vancouver or Burnaby.
Amazing, amazing.
They did a pagoda in Whitehorse.
Wow.
And then they played the One Note concert in St. John's.
Right, that's right, the One Note.
One Note, and he left the stage. And he says, I've now played in every province in Canada. Amazing.
Hey, while we just put that lower in the mix here, I want to hear about Dick Beddoes.
Yeah.
So tell us what you did for Dick Beddoes.
Well, while I was at CFRB, they signed Dick Beddoes, former CHCH broadcaster and you know, kind of a colorful character who had written for the Globe and Mail and others. And they asked me to be his call screener for his new Sunday night talk show.
Okay.
And I did that, and I liked Dick. He was very nice. He was always very nice to me. And he ended up, you know, he used to call me his producer. He produced his own show. Like, you didn't produce Dick Beddoes. But I was his call screener and just kept the show on the rails. And he kind of took me under his wing, and we really had a great relationship. He would constantly, every show, shout out to my mom.
Nice.
He would, because I think he talked to her on the phone one time when he was trying to reach me or whatever it was, and he just said, such a nice lady. Oh, Mike's mom. Oh, Mike's mom, Phyllis, is such a nice lady. And my mom just thought that was just the greatest thing of all time. So I would produce that show, and then after, I'm not sure how long we did it, he started to deteriorate. I could tell. He was slipping a little bit. And then his wife, who's also a very lovely woman, called me and said, listen, Dick has cancer.
Oh.
And we're not sure how much longer he has to live. He kept doing the show until he literally couldn't do the show.
Right.
Any longer. Superman. And then one day I'm at a Jays game. I'm covering a Jays game in the press box. The phone rings, and it's his wife. And they're at a hospital on Avenue Road, and Dick wants to see you.
Wow.
He called, she called, and I left the game after the game was over, drove up, parked, and went in, and he was near death, and he just looked at me, he smiled, you know, held his hand for 2 seconds, and paid my respects, and he passed away the next day. And I still have all the obituaries from the newspapers. He was a legendary figure. Also, a curler who played in the Brier representing the club that I play at when I curl now, Vancouver Curling Club. He was in the Brier from the Vancouver Curling Club in the 60s or 50s or something like that. So his name's up on the wall. Dick Beddoes.
Dick Beddoes, the legend.
With a hat.
I'm of an age where I absolutely remember Dick the Beddoes hat. On CHCH. And yep. He wrote the Pal Hal book.
Pal Hal. He wrote a bunch of books about hockey.
Right.
He gave me some autographed copies. I still cherish.
Wow.
What a guy. You know, and colorful. Oh, my God. And then we had one night with Hank Olesik on, and they started talking about some stuff that was a little off color, and I had to cut the mic, and it was, oh, my God. He was talking about...
There's a name for you,
groupies
Hank Olesik.
Groupies in the NFL. It was, oh, Jesus. Anyway.
Well, here, I teased the clip from CFRB, so I'm going to play it right now. Okay, this is the 1991 clincher.
Joe Carter's RBI single in the bottom of the ninth inning completed a two-run Blue Jay rally to give the Jays a 6-5 win over the Angels. Toronto clinching the American League East for the second time in 3 years. Carter's blue pit just barely passed the Angels' drawn-in infield, scoring Roberto Alomar from third base with the winning run. Devon White led off the inning with a single off Angels ace reliever Brian Harvey. Alomar then hit a hard ground ball to second baseman Kevin Flora. Flora tried for the force out at second base but threw the ball into left field for an error. That allowed White to score to tie the game 5-5. Alomar then stole third, setting the stage for Carter's dramatic game-winning hit. Mike Timlin gets the win in relief. He's now 11-6. Timlin actually gave up two hits in the top of the ninth, allowing California to take a 5-4 lead. Carter, the hero, defensively as well. A great throw to home plate in the ninth to save another run and end the inning. Brian Harvey takes the loss and is now 2-4. Final score, Blue Jays 6, Angels 5. Blue Jays clinch the American League East. Mike Hanafin, CFRB Sports at the Sky Dome.
And I can remember that because with those kind of voicers, you had to do that as soon as the game was over, like instantly call the station or the network and file that. And I had a script, of course, with the Angels winning, and now we got to go another game, blah, 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 blah. And of course, everything happens, and now I've got to have my voice. And that mostly was winged.
Okay, good.
Just a few small notes, and well, I've done it a few thousand times. So, and that, you know, it's funny you play that because that kind of experience set the stage for 93.
Okay.
Because that was the ultimate. Rewrite everything, throw out your script, you've got a voice already, and then you know what happens.
I do know what happens, but do I have this clip? Because I know the second time...
That would be the Joe Pavia clip.
Okay, so I'll tell you what I have here. This is a little on-air meeting, as Humble and Fred might say. So I have a Canada Cup final.
Yeah, that's...
No, that's not it. But that's actually all I've got left for you. So here, but here, I'm going to roll into a jam, and then I'm going to search my email.
Because I might have sent it as a separate email.
Okay, I'm going to look for it.
It's a longer clip.
If I have it, I'll find it.
Yeah.
Let's listen to another one of Mike Hanafin's jams. Good Toronto band.
The greatest Canadian band.
Is this your favorite song of all time? I mean, sorry, your favorite band
song
of all time?
It's in my top three. Zeppelin, these guys, and maybe...
it's a tough question.
Tough one. But they're in my top three. And I have a story about...
Yeah, let's hear it.
I played tennis with Alex Lifeson one time.
Woo! He golfs too, because
now
I know
he golfs.
Howard
he
has golfed
anymore.
With the guy.
So when I was probably probably, I don't know, maybe at CFRB, maybe CFNY, probably CFNY.
Okay.
I got invited to play in a celebrity media tennis tournament at the Ontario Racquet Club down in Mississauga.
Okay.
And I got to play doubles with Alex Lifeson.
Wow.
And Alex Lifeson's probably still laughing, or maybe, you know, not now, but whatever. He's going, he probably went home that night and goes, I'm playing tennis and this guy's asking me about Caress of Steel. Because I was asking him questions about
Russia. He
probably
loved it.
I'm playing tennis with Alex Lifeson, playing doubles. And I'm asking him, well, what about, you know, Caress of Steel? And he had the pat answer, which he uses all the time. Well, we had to do Caress of Steel in order to know how to do 2112.
Right.
Because there was a lot of long segments. And so I'm asking him all kinds of questions. Well, we're playing doubles between points. Because when are you going to get another chance to ask questions to Alex Lifeson?
Wow.
Played tennis with Alex Lifeson. I use that one. I've used that one quite a bit to get.
That's amazing. And did you ever bump into Geddy Lee at the Dome or
no.
at Exhibition Stadium before
no,
that?
No, I did not.
Okay.
I'm not sure. He was a baseball fan all his life, but I don't think it was an obsession until later on.
Well, you know he's a big fan because he scores his own games.
Oh, yeah. And that's
most people aren't doing that anymore. So.
It's a lost art, and that's why I'm doing it in Vancouver.
I know Wilner still does it, yep. Mike Wilner.
I get paid to do it, though.
So touch on that while we're talking about it. So I think that's awesome. I know Roger Lajoie, who's an FOTM, would occasionally score games at the Dome. But
3 years ago, I scored a pass when I was here because I'm the official scorer for the Vancouver Canadiens, which is the Jays affiliate.
So what level is this?
That's single A.
Single A, okay.
So I was in Toronto, and I knew I was coming to Toronto, see my mom, see friends.
Yeah.
And I got a pass to go up in the press box, pregame only. And I sat with Raj and we talked about scoring and the difference between major league scoring and minor league scoring and the different things like that, and had a nice conversation. Then I sat in the crowd and watched the game.
Amazing.
Yeah.
And you've been doing this for how long?
Since 2011 with the C's.
Okay.
It's just after I got let go in radio and broadcasting, I had to do something and I got a gig doing this. And I've never stopped.
Amazing. Yeah. Okay, we're going to let Geddy take us home, and then I'm going to play the clip. I have located the missing clip.
There it
so,
is.
And
this is from
this is from 1993.
Of the home run.
Okay, an infamous night to a point where there's a Mikeumentary about this night.
And I came too late to this party.
I know, you would have been
on
that episode. So
shout out here to Joe Pavia, who now works for CBC and KW. He was the overnight newscaster at CFRB. The night of the Carter home run, and Joe called me in the press box after I'd filed my initial voicer. He calls me and he says, listen, can I just do, you know, a 2 or 3 minute, you know, Q&A with you? And he recorded it and he used it overnight.
Okay, let's hear
it. Toronto's news station, CFRB 1010.
Good morning. It's 1:30. I'm Joe Pavia, CFRB News. The temperature in downtown Toronto is 9 degrees. Mainly clear overnight with a low near 8. We're partying in Metro tonight. Joe Carter hit a beautiful home run in the bottom of the ninth to give the Blue Jays their second World Series title in a row. 8-6, the final score. There's no movement in downtown Toronto. South of Dundas, a sea of people. One police officer estimated at least 1 million people are downtown celebrating the win. More on their way down there. Joe Carter was the man who gave the Jays the win with a 3-run homer in the bottom of the ninth. Now, CFRB's Mike Hanafin is at Sky Dome, and Mike, I guess it's a lot quieter now.
Well, they're now tearing apart the field at Sky Dome for the final time this year.
I think there was an Argo game the next night.
To see everything get knocked down less than an hour after Joe Carter hit the home run right in front of me. I was sitting in the left field bleachers. That's where they had the auxiliary press box, and the home run literally landed right in front of me in the Blue Jay bullpen. Pandemonium, 52,000 plus going crazy. The fans going crazy in the stands. The Blue Jays came flying out of their own dugout. One of those scenes that lives on in history where Carter hits the home run and the players come flying out of the bench to watch to make sure it stayed fair. It did. And an emotional Joe Carter after the game said he was very proud of his and the team's accomplishment.
You go out there and you play hard and you try to give it your best, and you know, anything can happen. And this team never gave up. We believed in ourselves. We had to come back against a great team, the Phillies. You know, guys persevered. You know, everyone talked about how many guys we lost. But they never really talked about the guys we gained. And we gained some quality guys, but we also had some great guys. And for something like this to happen, I mean, Cito was great last year. He was even better this year.
Joe Carter of the Blue Jays, the hero tonight, as the Blue Jays win their second straight World Series title, the first time they've done it at home so let the parties begin.
And, Mike, I guess that is something Joe Carter is never going to forget.
Never, and no one who ever saw it live will ever forget it either. A dramatic game-winning home run to win a World Series. They talk about the 1975 series where Carlton Fisk hit the home run to win a game. That was not the home run to win the series. That one just simply won game. This one won the whole shebang, and Joe Carter, you know, Joe Carter was very close to not being a Blue Jay this year. He signed as a free agent. He thought about going to Kansas City. Now he says the best decision he ever made in his life, coming back to Toronto for this.
You know, it was beautiful, Mike. I was sitting there watching, and I thought, you know, it would be great if Carter could do something here, because he was the guy who caught the ball in the last out last year.
And he brought it up. Yeah. He caught the ball to win the World Series at first base. If you remember, in the ALCS against Chicago, he caught the game-winning fly ball to end that series. And he says he made the prediction to his teammates before the series started that he had to do something, because he was always in there whenever they won. Except this time he said, maybe I'll do it offensively. And he was very prophetic. A madhouse in the Blue Jay clubhouse after the game, as you'd expect. The champagne and beer flowing. Paul Molitor was the series MVP, and well-deserved. He had an incredible series. He had a home run tonight, 12 hits in, 24 at-bats, so he had an even 500, I believe, in the series. And he had the single right before Joe Carter's home run to set the stage off Mitch Williams. The Wild Thing gave up the home run. Williams was not a happy man in the Phillies clubhouse. Said a few choice words and then said, listen, I feel worse for my teammates because I'm the one who blew it. He admitted it. Joe Carter hit the home run, and the rest is history.
Mike Hanafin, thank you very much. By the way, Mike, you didn't happen to get that ball that Carter hit, did you?
one of the Blue Jay bullpen guys grabbed it, and I imagine it's going to be somewhere, either in the Blue Jay Hall of Fame or the Baseball Hall of Fame in Cooperstown. Someone's going to get it. And it was, I can make some catches, but I would have had to reach about 15 feet, and I had other things to do. I think I was finally
CFRB's Mike Hanafin down at the Sky Dome. Mike, thank you very much. Briefly, firefighters are on the scene of a gas station fire at Western Road.
The news continues.
Amazing.
Yeah. And that shout out to Joe Pavia. It's amazing that he saved that recording, and then he offered it up to me, and I was like, hey, I got a recording of you that night. I'm like, bring it on.
You know, you're playing all my favorite bands on your jam kicking today. I almost feel like I'm kicking out the jams here. So let's roll into another one.
Oh, yes. Lyric ahead.
And if you go to hell, I still remember you. But I thought you'd be the death of an evident man. I needed it just a little bit. I thought you'd be me.
The Tragically Hip.
What an awesome lyric that is.
Yeah. Gord came up, I want to say this was a topic of conversation. Yes, yesterday with Torquil Campbell, we talked about how, like, there's just, as a front man goes, you know, there's only ever going to be one Gord Downie.
So the reason I threw this in, because I do have a story about this gentleman. I'm at Canadian Press Broadcast News after a Leaf game or something some night. I was filing, you know, freelance things, and I'd gone to the game, and I come back with my tape, and I'm in a studio to edit the tape, cut the tape into clips, and, you know, write the leads and everything else. And in an adjoining studio, this gentleman in a hoodie comes in, tall gentleman in a hoodie. It's the middle of winter,
right.
And he is in there to be interviewed. I don't even know who it is. And the Canadian press guy was doing an interview with him, and it's Gord Downie.
Wow.
And I'm in the next booth listening to, you know, some Leaf guy talk, and I'm looking at the board, and I'm going, one of these buttons will allow me to hear this interview.
Right.
And I'm like, I'm certain, okay, because you can, you know, the boards and everything are all connected in the studios, and I'm looking, okay, is Studio 2? Like, and I'm trying, and then I thought, if I hit the wrong button, I'm in big trouble.
Right.
And I never did.
Ooh,
and it was Gord Downie.
Gord Downie. So were you're a fan of the Tragically Hip?
Absolutely.
Okay. All right. So, man, if you got, you know, you kicked out the jams today, and I heard Public Enemy, I heard Pearl Jam, I heard the Tragically Hip. Honestly, there's a lot of overlap here. I dig this the most, man.
Yeah.
Amazing. Now, I could hear Gord stories all day, except I want to hear a story if you have one, and I think you might, because a little birdie told me. So just to preface this, I got a phone call from Blair Packham from the Jitters. You got the Jitters on your jam kicking today? Okay, where's the Jitters? Well, Blair's going to hear this, so pretend it was you did and I accidentally deleted it. Sorry, Blair, we did, but it's gone. Last of the Red Hot Fools was one of your jams. So, but anyway, he was talking about U of T Radio where he knew Andrew Crystal from. Yep. Not his real name, by the way. Yep. He was Andrew something else. Anyway, also at U of T Radio at this time are FOTM's Steve Pakin and Michael Landsberg. You take it over
well,
from here.
Well, I'm working... I was accepted for engineering and decided I didn't want to be an engineer. I wanted to be a sportscaster. So I decided I dropped everything and I went to Arundel College, U of T Arundel College.
Now called UTM.
AUTM. So I'm there and I walk into their radio station and say, well, I'd like to be a sportscaster. And they said, okay, you're the sportscaster. Because there was no other sportscaster. So I'm the sportscaster.
You got the gig.
So I'm a sportscaster on the Arundel station. And then I get a phone call someday saying, listen, you know, we do U of T football and we'd like to get you involved. And I said, sure. So I show up at Varsity Stadium, and I'm going to do the broadcast. And I don't know who the people I'm going to be doing the broadcast with. It's Steve Pakin.
Wow.
Steve Pakin and I were the play-by-play in color for one game.
One game.
And our producer was Michael Landsberg.
Okay, so Steve will listen to this episode.
Absolutely.
And we will find out, does FOTM Steve Pakin remember his one game?
I've reminded him of this.
Okay, with Mike Hanafin. Yes. Okay.
And Landsberg. And because I ended up working with Landsberg later at TSN. But anyway, so we do the game, and there was one player on U of T, Sam Papakonstantino, who must have made 30 tackles.
Okay.
And we constantly had to keep saying the name, and we butchered it. All night.
Papa Constantino.
Yes. It's now easy to say. And Steve and I were doing the game, and we had a blast. And then years later, he's a big star, and I'm a sportscaster.
So, well, you know, you're both big stars in somebody else's
sky.
But
he's Steve Pakin.
He's Steve fucking Pakin.
He is.
Don't you forget
he's
it,
amazing.
Okay? I don't see any Frank Sinatra on your list.
Not
he's going to be disappointed. But there is this jam, and I'm going to kick it out right now.
Thank you.
Shout out to FOTM Mike Baguski. This is Blue Rodeo.
Probably a band I've seen probably as much as, almost as much as any band I've ever seen in my life, because they play all the time, everywhere.
Right.
I've seen them in Toronto, I've seen them in Vancouver. I've never seen them play this song, my favorite song of theirs of all.
You know what I'm thinking? I've seen them a handful of times too, including last summer.
They never play this song live.
No, wonder why that is. When I get Jim Cuddy on the show, I'm going to find out.
Please do, because I think maybe it's just too guitar, too much of a guitar song.
But it is a great song.
It's an unbelievable
from a very
song.
Popular album.
And I'm a very, I think that's their best album.
Yeah,
I know a lot of people go
Outskirts. Or
no, 6 Days in May.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
But I love this album, Lost Together. It's one of my favorite albums of all time.
Yeah.
And I'm very partial to Keeler songs.
Yeah, me too.
I think he's just a brilliant...
And what's your favorite? Is this your favorite Blue Rodeo song?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay,
yeah,
I like a Diamond Mine.
Yeah, and a great song. But yeah, I've never seen them play this song live, and I've seen them so many times. And I heard on Humble and Fred, maybe it was on your podcast as well, that there was a Keeler reference about him...
Oh,
when
you
Bobby
know who that
in
was?
The 72 series.
Jeff Merrick dropped that one.
No, Scott Morrison.
No, Jeff Merrick.
No, well, maybe they both had, but Scott was pushing his book, right? About the 72 series?
Scott Morrison, because he was on my show too, Scott, pushing his 72 Summit series book, which is very good.
On Tumble and Fred.
But I can tell you this, we'll just later.
Maybe Merrick was first to it.
I don't think Scott told that story, but you would, anyway, this is a crazy argument, because yeah, absolutely, on Humble and Fred, I think Jeff Merrick, you think Scott Morrison, somebody shared the story, and do you remember
Orr. It was Bobby Orr was injured, and they wanted him to play in the Summit series in 72, and he went and tried to skate around at...
Oh, that is a Scott. I'm thinking of a different story.
No. And they had Bobby Orr's running around, you know, just testing his knee.
Right.
And the goalie was Greg Keeler.
Right.
Who was like a second string
junior
or college goalie.
Right.
And they needed a goalie. And that was Greg Keeler.
Greg Keeler. Okay. So later you'll be phoning me when you check the tapes. You'll say, oh, that was Jeff Merrick. But the gentleman Jeff Merrick, as we say. But was that reference, of course, Bobby Orr wanting to play in the Summit Series. Scott Morrison talked about that. Yep. Yeah. But he did travel with the team to Moscow,
absolutely,
which was very, very cool. Yep. I enjoyed my 1972 deep dive with Scotty Moe.
That was amazing. I was 13.
So that's a good age. I think that's a great age to soak that in. Yeah. That's one of those memories I don't have, but I feel like I have it.
And again, you can't forget it. That whole thing. I mean, the Esposito interview with Johnny Esau in Vancouver.
Love it.
And, Mahovlich goal.
And then the Paul Henderson. The game winner in the final three games.
Three games in a row.
Amazing.
And then, there you go.
The rest is history, as we say. So, yeah, absolutely. 72 Summit Series. So, where are we at here? Now, I'm
end
trying to
CFRB.
Get you... Okay, so, let me play one final clip. In fact, if I'm...
That's a Canada Cup thing.
Yeah, let's do the Canada Cup thing, since we just talked hockey.
I got
here.
To cover hockey a lot, and that Canada Cup series was amazing. I got to cover the other one, too, the Lemieux scoring the game-winning
87.
Goal, but I don't have any tape on that one. I wish I did.
That's the more famous. Yeah. In fact, I had this chat with Scott Morrison. So, you know, we all talk about 2010 because it was a golden goal, and 72 because it transcended sports. And the sometimes forgotten... Oh, it was with Tim Warnsby. So... Yep. He wrote a book about the 02 gold medal team.
Oh, yeah.
And that one gets overlooked.
Salt Lake City.
Yeah, and that was the first Canadian gold in 50 years.
Mm-hmm.
So the way I have it set up, because we're going to jam here, and I'm going to bring that down, but not all the way down. And now we're going to listen to this.
Steve Larmer's shorthanded goal with 7:47 left in the third period led Team Canada to a 4-2 win over Team USA and a two-game sweep in the Canada Cup final. Larmer, stealing the puck from USA defenseman Gary Suter at the Canadian blue line, went in on a breakaway, and after a deke to his backhand, Larmer put the puck between the legs of goaltender Mike Richter. Larmer's second goal of the game coming just seconds after Canadian goaltender Bill Ranford stopped Brett Hall from close range. Dirk Graham scored an empty net goal with 42 seconds left to make it a 4-2 final. Team Canada led 2-0 after the first period on goals by Mark Messier and Larmer. Team USA tied it with two goals in the second by Jeremy Roenick and Kevin Miller. Bill Ranford named tournament MVP. Final score, Team Canada 4, USA 2. Canada winning the final in two straight games. Mike Hanafin, CFRB Sports at the Cops Coliseum in Hamilton.
Cool.
And that's another one of those voicer, as soon as the game's over and the crowd is still going nuts, and you could hear in the background they were yelling Gretzky, Gretzky.
Right.
Because Gretzky was hurt in the previous game because Suter got him.
Right.
And that's why I put the emphasis on Gary Suter being the GOAT in that last game, giving up the puck to Larmer. And, yeah, they were yelling, they were chanting Gretzky because he came out on the ice to celebrate with them in his civvies.
Amazing. Yeah. Okay, that's awesome. I'm rolling right into the next jam. We got three more to go. This is one of your favorite bands of all time. I'm going to roll into it, and then we're going to find out why you leave CFRB. Here is your anti-penultimate jam. Not the Beastie Boys, everybody.
No.
Zeppelin.
The drums.
Yeah.
Jimmy Page, one of the greatest producers of rock music of all time, obviously. He set up Bonzo's drum kit in a hallway of an old house to get that sound, that echo and that whole thing.
Sure.
And he had the microphone set up all over the place, and he got that sound, which is just stunning. The start of that and then all the way through. Only he would think of that.
And he's in that dock with Jack White.
Yep.
It might get loud.
And The Edge.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amazing. I'm a huge Zeppelin fan, and that's one of my favorite Zeppelin songs. And it's just, and then the Beastie Boys
of course
sampled it with permission.
Are you sure?
Well, eventually. Yeah. But just that sound. Just
amazing. No,
the echo is unbelievable.
Great jam by a band. I'm certain I underappreciate this band because I only know like the radio hits, and I only ever owned one. I only ever owned one Led Zeppelin album, which is Led Zeppelin 4.
Yeah,
which a lot of
I think it was a
rite of passage as a teen.
You had to have that.
And I liked going to California. Well, I liked a lot of the stuff. Yeah, but,
and again, I grew up with that band, and I remember the day Bonzo died. I'm driving home from Humber College in my little car that only had an AM radio, and I have Chum on, and Chum never played Zeppelin.
Right.
And they play Zeppelin, and I'm driving home, and there's a Zeppelin song. I'm going, wow, great. And then they played another Zeppelin song, and I'm going, what? And then they played Moby Dick, and I knew right there. When Chum would play three Zeppelins and a Moby Dick, Bonzo's dead. And he was. September 25th, and I want to say 80. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Zeppelin.
Glad you're kicking out your favorite jams here. We only have two more to go, but I want to get a couple of stories out of you during this jam in the background here. Why does it end for you at 10:10?
There was no more sports to cover in 94 because hockey had their lockout and baseball went on strike. And right. When you're a reporter and there's no games and you're a freelancer, you make no money.
Right.
And so time was up. Now, having said that,
yeah,
I'm at the one of the negotiations were happening with the NHL Players Association, and I made, you know, I'd made connections with the TSN people and Gino Retta.
FOTM Gino Retta.
Gino Retta. He comes up to me at some point and he asks me, listen, the negotiations are going to go overnight. If something breaks, can you call our newsroom? Because I was staked out
right. At
NHLPA headquarters at Dundas and Yonge Street.
Okay.
Near the Eaton Center.
Yep.
And if something happens overnight, can you call our newsroom? And if we send a camera, can you hold the mic for us? I said, absolutely. You know, I'm a freelancer. I'm picking up the bucks anywhere I can.
Right.
And I did that. Nothing happened. But, you know, they appreciated that. And Gino, at the end of it, says, listen, how'd you like to come work for TSN? I keep telling him, you know, like, we got this guy out there. This is, you know, knows sports. And we could use a guy like that in the newsroom. And there were no sports to cover. And he hooked me up with Mike Day, who was the boss of Sports Center at the time.
Okay.
And I got in the newsroom a couple days a week, became four, became five, became full-time job, and then I worked at TSN from, I want to say, 94 to 2001.
Awesome.
And the highlight, probably one of the highlights, I got to do Formula One auto racing. I was the associate producer of Formula One, so I would put together all the pre-race shows when Villeneuve was at his peak. And I got to go to I was the field producer at the 1996 Olympics with FOTM Rod Smith.
Wow.
And Rod and I and Mark Millett was our camera. The three of us tried to cover the Olympics. Non-rights holders in those days,
right,
which meant you had no eligibility to be anywhere with anything electronic. You couldn't bring a camera, a tape recorder, anything inside the barricades.
Right.
And we covered the Olympics, and Rod, and it was, you know, fun, frustrating, but fun.
Right.
We got kicked out of one place. We went to, before the games even started, we were at the rowing venue to see if we could get some B-roll. And we're, you know, shooting B-roll of rowers off in the distance, and a car comes up, and it's Chris Cuthbert of CBC at the time.
Yeah.
And Chris, great guy, comes up and he goes, guys, you can't be here. You can't be here. You're inside the perimeter with a camera. And right. We're saying, well, the games haven't started. No, no, it doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter.
And so he gave us a heads up, and we packed up all our gear and we said, okay, we're burning this tape. We can't, because if it played, we would have had our passes pulled.
Right.
So we just
saved your
we
ass.
Packed up and left, and like, you know, 5-10 minutes later, the IOC police probably
right.
came up, and so we got out of there. But the highlight of the games for us,
yeah,
was the night that Donovan Bailey and the 4x100 team won the gold, and we staked out. We had to get the interview because that's all we were really trying to do was we were trying to interview one-on-one Rod with the medal winners.
Right.
And anytime a person won a medal, we had to get the interview, but we had no rights to be anywhere.
Right.
So what we did is we figured out a place right at the entrance to the Athletes Village. There was a BP gas station. And so we would park there and we would stake out the entrance and then get them to drop off the athletes in the bus or the car or whatever at the place. And then Rod would do the one-on-one interview. We'd be in touch with their agents or their, you know, their handlers or whatever. And we'd arrange to meet them there. And we'd do that. But with the 4x1, we couldn't do that because CBC took them away to do the radio, the French, the English, the TV and everything else.
Right.
And so we staked out outside of CBC's big building. And we were on the phone. Rod was on the phone. The RDS, the French TSN, was on the phone with Bernie Sorin's agent. And we're outside, and we could see them coming down the escalator from the studio. And we're saying, we're outside. We're flashing. And we had Mark flash the sun gun on the camera, flashing the light. We're outside. Just come out the door. And the CBC people are trying to, you know, corral them, keep right. them moving, keep them moving down to the next escalator. So
wow.
And they said, nope, we're going up and talk to them. And they came out the door, and they talked to us. And Rod did a 1-on-4 with all the guys.
Amazing.
And we did the interview.
Can you name the four? I
saw them the other day. It was, well, Surin, Bailey. And there was a guy that was not supposed to run that ended up running, right?
Robert Esme.
Esme.
Yeah. And then Glenroy
Gilbert. And then Glenroy Gilbert.
Yeah.
And what a race. Yeah, oh, yeah. It was just unbelievable.
Oh, man. It's funny because, I mentioned just this morning, Donovan Bailey sitting there for his podcast. So the whole idea that every Tuesday of 2022 thus far, I've spent, quality time with Donovan Bailey. Yeah. And when he came on Toronto Mike and became an FOTM, I played the calls, the CBC calls of the...
Don...
The 100-meter... Don Whitman, absolutely. And then, of course, the 4x100-meter. But, man, that's only... Let me do the math. That's only 8 years removed from Ben Johnson and Seoul. Yeah. So it was really what this country needed, and it was amazing.
Great thing. And then Mike Day, the boss of TSN, he rewarded us for getting that scoop with pick a restaurant and go nuts.
Love it.
And we did.
Two more jams to go.
Yeah. Favorite Beastie Boys song.
One, two, one, two, keep it on. Listen to the shit because we keep it till dawn. Listen to the ass track, got it going on. Listen to the ladies, come on and let me spawn. Pour your eggs, then you go up the river. Listen to the ass track, that freaky nigga.
Now I'm at rock and I shock and I tick and I talk and I can't stop with the Bobby Ross. See, I got hot like John Stoss.
To the C, to the A, and it's a boss. The rhymes that we boss on the topic of lust.
And my mouth is not butt, but fuck it. Let me get down to the rhythm. Yes, I get funky and I'm shooting on my
chest. Dude, I love it. You're speaking my language here today. This is amazing.
And Q-Tip.
Yeah.
And this opened up a whole new world to me of the next jam, but whatever. You know, I just love BC Boys. It's just such a great... Different, completely different.
Well, you know why? They were the hybrid, man. You got your funk, you got your hip hop, you got your rock, your punk. Yeah. It's all
so
in
many
there.
Influences. They grew up in New York, and there was just so much coming at them, and they kind of synthesized everything into this.
And I just love, give me some Tribe Called Quest any day of the week and twice on Sundays.
I listen to Tribe Called Quest now all the time, and this opened my eyes to Q-Tip.
Right.
And he was just guesting. They asked him to come in and do this, and he knocked it out of the park as usual. And then I go, Tribe Called Quest. And then I saw, this, and I saw.
Yeah, dude, speak my language. And you did bang your head on your way to the studio here because you didn't see the check your head sign there. So
I feel like that's a special club that has smacked their head.
It's a
on
large
the top
club, though. Okay. So we kind of breezed by it, but you were at CFNY for 4 years, and we did talk about James Baby Scott, and we talked about Pete and Geets, and we talked about Mike Stafford and Freddie P. Are there any other CFNY personalities you want to shout out and tell a story about?
Lots of them, but Scott Turner. He used to
FOTM Scott Turner.
He used to do evenings, and I would call in from the gardens, and I didn't think he'd be interested in hearing from, an update from Maple Leaf Gardens and the Leafs and, San Jose Sharks. But he did. He loved it because he'd hear the ambient noise, and then I would have some fun. We always made fun of the organ player. We talk about how he's wearing oven mitts.
Well, what year is this? Because he's still there. If it's Jimmy Holmstrom.
Yeah. It would have been Jimmy Holmstrom.
He's still there. I saw him there. I got a tour about a month ago, and he's still there.
Yeah. Well, and so I would phone in, and Scott Turner would throw me on the air, and he said, "Wow, keep doing it. I love it. I love it." And that kind of encouragement from,
Scott's a sweetheart.
Oh, unbelievable guy. and I'm so happy with the success he's had post-CFNY and all the different things he's done. Because that guy was so good, and you talk about people who are underrated. Like, there were so many stars on CFNY, and was he a star? I don't know. He was just a great DJ, and turned out, he's done so many great things since.
No argument here. Big fan of Scott Turner, and he'll be back here again soon. He always brings it too. Much like yourself, he comes very, very prepared. So. We appreciate
it. I only got one
shot
at this, my friend.
So we're rolling into the final jam.
Like my bell, I got the ill communication. My bell, got the ill communication. My bell, got the ill communication. My bell, got the ill communication.
bell. Keep it on and on and on and on.
The video for this is awesome as well.
Relax yourself, girl. Be set to man. 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 Honey, check it out. You got me mesmerized. With your black hair and your fat ass thighs. Street poetry is my everyday. But yo, I gotta stop when you drop my way. If I was working at the club, you would not pay. Ayo, my man Fife Diggy, he got something to say.
I like him brown, yellow, Puerto Rican, and Haitian. Name is Fife Borg from the Zulu Nation. Told you in the jam that we could get down. Now let's knock the boots like the group H-Town. You got BBD all on your bedroom wall. But I'm above the rim and this is how I ball. A gritty little something on the New York street. This is how I represent over this here beat. Talking about you.
Yo, I took you out.
Love it. Tribe Called Quest.
Such a great tune to listen to. You're driving and just relax. And, you know, they do all kinds of different things. Sure. This is a bit of a departure in a lot of ways, but this is my favorite song from Tribe Called Quest.
Love it. Love the band. You know, again, we talk about the hybrid, right? They were basically like jazz, hip-hop, fusion. It was amazing.
And Q-Tip's so talented. Yeah. Picking samples of something. Anything, just picking a little beat, a drum beat, and then looping it and turning it into a song. Just amazing.
So here, before we play Lowest of the Low and say goodbye here, I've thoroughly enjoyed this, but I need to know what happens in 2005, because we've talked about, you know, we just left you at TSN. We know next you're working with Rosie at the Weather Network. Then something must happen in 2005, because you quit everything, you sell everything, and you move to Vancouver. What the hell happened?
Well, in 2003, I took a few months off, and I traveled. And I traveled across the country, drove across the country, and I got to see different places. And I got to Vancouver and the West Coast and the mountains and the trees and the forests and the hiking and everything else. And I just went, wow, this is me. Right. I just didn't know it.
Right.
And I just decided to pack it up. Sold my place. I made some contacts and told people I was going to be coming out in radio and TV, and managed to get some work. And I ended up working at the 680 News of Vancouver, News 1130. Worked there until 2010, and then I got, you know, packaged with everybody else and Purge. And I'm not going to be leaving there anytime soon.
But then you just pick up some freelance work. You're doing that. You talked about curling because you did it at TSN, but you got to work on some Sportsnet curling broadcasts.
Yeah, I picked up a few things. When Sportsnet was doing the BC Provincials, I ended up hooking up because Dave Tredget, who worked at TSN when I was there, he ended up going over to Sportsnet, and he hooked me up with some work whenever they were doing stuff in BC. So that was good.
Amazing.
A couple of things. I'm doing no media anymore.
No, but you're still scoring for the Vancouver Canadiens. Yep. Which is freaking cool. Yeah, so, and I mean, I take it you're just hiking and biking and living that wonderful, you know, natural lifestyle out west. And now I'm feeling very jealous.
As long as my back holds out, which I'm having back surgery soon. But but that hopefully will be putting me right back in the mountains again, doing my thing.
Mike Hanafin, you're an FOTM now, and thanks for doing this. I'm glad we could make this happen while you were in town. Because when do you go back home?
Leaving Thursday night.
Oh, we got this in just
election
under the
day.
Wire. Election day. Get out of here.
I'll watch the landscape burn from the plane.
Oh, that's a whole another story. Another story for another episode. But enjoy the Jays game tonight.
Thank you.
You know, speaking of curling, we talked about curling. I remember Rosie worked for Dome Productions.
Yeah.
And she would work. That's when I met Andrew Stokely. And Stokely has done his fair. He'll be at the Dome tonight doing the audio for Sportsnet. Cool. But he's done his fair share of curling broadcasts himself. So
I'm a curler myself. So
okay,
natural fit.
Shout out to the curlers. And that. Oh, you know what I never promoted? I'm going to do it right now before I tell you what's coming up next. We're all collecting Stu Stone, Andy from Canada Cabana, Canada Kev, maybe Kareem. We're all collecting in my backyard tonight at 8 p.m. and we're going to just kick out some stoner jams. We're going to talk about anything and everything and some weed. We're going to get a new project from Stu Stone is going to be unveiled. We're going to hear new music from Stu. It's going to be great. So join us at live.torontomike.com at 8 p.m. Of course, most of you won't hear this till after that. But it'll be up down. We'll record it for the podcast. But I want to shout out Canna Cabana. This is going to be the Canna Cabana episode. So that's 8 p.m. tonight. And that brings us to the end of our 1058th show. You can follow me on Twitter. I'm at Toronto Mike. Are you at Mike Hanafin?
Correct.
Okay, follow Mike. He's at Mike Hanafin. Our friends at Great Lakes Brewery are at Great Lakes Beer. Palma Pasta is at Palma Pasta. Sticker U is at Sticker U. Doer are at Doer Performance. Ridley Funeral Home are at Ridley FH. And Canna Cabana are at Canna Cabana _. See you all later today.